You're listening to the audio production of Philippians 3 and 4 Audio Lectures by Lynn H. Cohick, published by Zondervan and presented by the author. These audio lectures are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, Philippians Audio Lectures includes high-quality live recordings of college-level lectures that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources.
Philippians chapter 3, verses 1 through 14. Further, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you. Watch out for those dogs, those evildoers, those mutilators of the flesh. For it is we who are the circumcision, we who serve God by His Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh, though I myself have reason for such confidence. If someone else thinks they have reason to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. In regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church. And as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of His resurrection and participation in His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death, and so, somehow, attaining to the resurrection of the dead. Not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. As we explore this rich text, you might also consider looking at Numbers 25, verses 1 through 9, Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 22 through 36, and then from the Apocrypha, 1 Maccabees 2, verses 23 through 26, 2 Maccabees chapter 2, verses 21, and then also from chapter 4, verse 13. One of my favorite movies is The Mission that was done in 1986. It talks about the slave trade along the Paraguay River in the 18th century. One of the most powerful scenes in this movie involves a former slave trader, Mendoza, played by Robert De Niro, who is climbing an impossibly rocky, wet cliff beside a cascading waterfall, and he has this bulky, heavy load on his back. And he finally reaches the top to find the rest of his party up there who are Jesuit priests. And they're waiting for the indigenous tribesmen that they've come to serve. As he stumbles up to the group, one of the tribesmen walks over and without a word cuts loose the pack, sending it cascading down the mountain. Well, after his initial shock, Mendoza begins to cry. Even to sob with gratitude. You see, carrying that pack was his penance for killing his brother in a duel years earlier, and its removal symbolizes that his sins were forgiven, the burden cast away forever. The tribesman who cut the pack off knew Mendoza was a slave trader, knew that he had taken people like the tribesman's clan. And he cut the pack. His sins are forgiven. Is that a picture of the Apostle Paul? Oftentimes we imagine Paul in the same way, trudging alone under the burden of the law, bent double under the weight of his sin. But that image is actually inconsistent with Paul's own telling of his story, as we see here in Philippians. We can also look at it a bit in the first chapter of Galatians. In this autobiographical note here in Philippians, Paul emphasizes his journey from his Jewish boyhood to his call to be an apostle to the Gentiles and his new life in Christ. And he offers a story, I think, here in Philippians as an alternative to what is being presented to the Philippians, this other gospel given by these dogs, these mutilators of the flesh, his Jewish Christian opponents, who seem to be demanding in some way that the Gentile believers take up the ethnic markers of Judaism. Typically, these markers include circumcision, food laws, Sabbath observance. What Paul shows us here in Philippians is that he stands entirely opposed to the proposal that Gentiles must become Jews in order to be full citizens in the church. And so let me summarize quickly the movement here in these 14 verses. What we'll explore are the key theological and historical points, including we're going to look at this historical identity of this group that Paul identifies as dogs, those the mutilation group. Secondly, we'll look at the historical identity that Paul reveals about himself. And then finally, number three, the theological impact of Paul's teaching, looking at how he understands the righteousness of God, works of the law, faith in Christ, and knowing Christ in suffering and participating in Christ's resurrection. Well, Paul begins this passage with joy. His joy, though, Paul's joy is not equivalent to being happy. Rather, his joy is focused on what is to come. We're not talking here about a fleeting emotion. I think of Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 10, which talks about the joy of the Lord being one's strength. I think that's what Paul is driving at here. And this idea of strength, sometimes today we think of strength as having absolute power or being autonomous. Again, this is not what Paul is talking about here. The Philippian believers, right, they don't have political power. They don't vote for leaders. They don't have a governmental social safety net, right? There's not a thriving economy there in Philippi. They can live, some of them, hand to mouth. Strength, then, this joy that Paul is describing here, is found in the surety of God's provision. And so Paul writes, "It's no trouble to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you." Probably what Paul means here is that in his earlier visit, he talked about the gospel message that he has presented so far in the first two chapters. And he is also probably has talked with them about some ways in which others have twisted or compromised the gospel. But notice here, Paul says, it's no trouble to write the same things to you. And so he's likely pointing to the previous chapters that he wrote. And again, what he's driving at here is that they would feel safe, they would feel confident that they would be able to stand firm in God's provision. And now Paul launches into talking about the opponents more directly. So he's getting into the meat of his argument here. Paul talks about these evildoers. These are probably believers, those who would say that they are believers, who nevertheless are interested in Gentiles in some way expressing Jewish practices to be able to be full members within the church. The church has dealt with this problem. Paul will talk about it in his letters, but also you can look at Acts 15, where in the Jerusalem meeting there, the apostles and elders talked about the expectations for Gentiles. And in that meeting, they concluded that Gentiles do need to step away from their idolatry and sexual immorality, but that they did not need to pick up Sabbath observance, food laws, or circumcision. I'd suggest to you also that the opponents that Paul is talking about here in verse 2 are likely the same people that he will address in verse 18 of the same chapter, and we'll get to that a little bit later. We find Paul talking in a similar way to the Galatians. Paul says to the Galatians in chapter 3, he says, who has bewitched you, right? Somebody in their mix is encouraging Gentiles to be circumcised as well as confessing Christ so that they can be full members of the church. And Paul reminds the Galatians that they didn't receive the Spirit by embracing circumcision, but rather by receiving the gospel. Paul will, in chapter 4 of Galatians then, say to the Galatians that they didn't formally know God. They were pagans. And so they were slaves to weak and miserable principles or powers of this world. And in verse 8 through 11 in chapter 4, he says to the Galatians, don't go back to them. It's interesting that Paul will talk about their pagan practices in chapter 4, but in chapter 3 of Galatians, it's very clear that the issue is circumcision, which is completely a Jewish issue, not a pagan issue. And yet Paul seems to connect the two, not because he would ever equate Judaism and paganism wholesale, not at all. What he is getting at is he's stressing that an alternative system, whether it's Judaism in practicing the law or whether it's paganism, both of those are part of the present age, not part of the age to come. But for those who are in Christ, they participate today, but also sort of with a foot in the age to come, because they are now in Christ, they are living under the power of the Spirit, and so it is both a now, not yet, but it's coming. So that argument in Galatians helps us understand what Paul is doing here, also in Philippians. He's arguing here in Philippians that Gentiles can be full members of the people of God because they are in Christ. What Paul is not doing here in chapter 3 is making a contrast between Judaism and Christianity. He's much more focused in assuring the Galatians and the Philippians that they, Gentiles who have turned to Christ, it's all they need to be full members of the family of God. Sins forgiven, members of God's family. But those who are these evildoers, as Paul talks about, they maintain that the Messiah would want Gentile believers to be clean, to be pure, and that would include then eating kosher food and resting on the Sabbath. But Paul speaks against this. So I mentioned Galatians to you. You could also look at Colossians chapter 4, verse 11. You could look at Ephesians chapter 2, 11 through 19. You could look at Titus chapter 1, verse 10. Again, Paul is not arguing here against opponents who say Gentiles must earn their salvation. That's not what the opponents are saying. He's combating the view that holy, righteous living can happen as one is in Christ and doing the law. Paul has strong rhetoric here against these dogs, these mutilators of the flesh, these evildoers. Jesus also, in his preaching, can exhibit strong rhetoric. We live in a world today that exhibits strong rhetoric. How does a Christian navigate this? What might be some important principles we can take from this and from other areas in the New Testament? When we see Jesus preaching, he shows us that he does not attack individuals by name. The only time he ever did this was when he talked about Herod Antipas. This is in Luke 13:32. Otherwise, Jesus speaks broadly about the abuse of power, about the failure to teach correctly, about the lack of concern from others, and he addresses the Jewish leadership of his day, but he speaks in broad brush strokes, addressing the issues, the character flaws that accompany this negative social behavior. Jesus, though, refused to defend his person against attack, and we see this in Paul as well. We saw this in chapter 1, verses 15 through 17. So a lesson for us today may be to stick very close to the topic of debate. Don't venture into the realm of personal comment, presumption of motives.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.